Sunday for the most intellectual interactive radio show. It's The Discourse with Jimmy Disu. We're talking politics.
The opposition will do anything to remain in office.
The economy.
Things are really falling apart.
Social well-being.
Chewing gum is dirty and a filthy habit.
Everything in between. Ladies and gentlemen, live from the Classic FM studios in Lagos. Stay tuned this Sunday for the most intellectual interactive radio show. It's The Discourse with Jimmy Disu. We're talking politics.
The opposition will do anything to remain in office.
The economy.
Things are really falling apart.
Social well-being.
Chewing gum is dirty and a filthy habit.
Everything in between.
I don't like to call it religion. I like to call it spirituality.
It's The Discourse with Jimmy Disu every Sunday at 2 p.m. Brought to you by MTN. Ladies and gentlemen, live from the Classic FM studios in Lagos, it's The Discourse with Jimmy Disu, brought to you by MTN.
Surprise me,
we better.
And you can surprise me,
we better.
silent for weeks before his first tooth appeared. Then it finally came, and he never stopped smiling the whole day. When he took his first step, he went straight to the kitchen. And on his first day in school, I couldn't hold back the tears of joy. Now that he has come of age, I can't wait to see what his reaction will be when I give him his first MTN smartphone tomorrow.
This season, surprise your child with an MTN smartphone for as low as 13,000 Naira with a 3-month data bonus offer available at all designated MTN stores nationwide.
Good afternoon, everybody. You're welcome to, I almost said morning, I just go. There I go again. You're welcome to the Discourse with GVDC on Classic FM 97.3. And, Christmas is just about around the corner. Next week, we're going to have a small Christmas party for the kids here. That's what we're going to do next week. So you're going to look forward to it. And I'm going to get two of them, very good saxophone players, dazzle you with a few tunes next week, so you want to look forward to that. Okay, and before I go on to introduce my guest, I have a small message here from MTN, and MTN are saying that this is the festive season and they'll be celebrating it in a very surprising and unique way. They'll be showcasing and encouraging acts of kindness to not just MTN customers but Nigerians as a whole. That means that MTN could show up in your neighborhood at any time. I'm going for one just around the corner, once I finish here. And they want to brighten Nigerians' lives, and they are hoping to spread the holiday cheer by touching over 254,000 lives. That 254,000 gifts to give out. I don't know if a car is one of them. I hope if the car, just go grab it myself. But I'm sure there'll be phones and things like that. And this will be going from the 11th up to the 23rd of December with amazing surprises. Right. So. That's it. Look out for any yellow activity in your neighborhood. You just might get a gift. I have a very, 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 very good friend in the studio. We met, Kadari, how many years ago now?
7, 8.
That's more than that. Okay, let's just say 7 or 8 years. Let me tell you, because you heard a female voice, I know what your mind is thinking. Chico is grinning here, but it's not what you think. About 7 years ago, thereabouts, I breezed into Next newspapers, to handle the marketing function. And there was this stern lady. I used to call her Iron Lady back in the day. And then I saw this. I said, she's the editor. And that was Kadaria Ahmed. And I can say today, anytime, Next is the best newspaper that I've ever worked on. I can say that any day. I can say that any day. Next was a fantastic paper. Way back then, started by Dele Olojede, we didn't get the business model right, but when it comes to the paper,
the team was awesome.
Kadaria, how are you?
I'm fine.
Kadaria is going to be 50 this week. most women don't want you to know their age, but there you are. Kadaria is an open book. She might be stern looking, which I think is a cover, because inside her is that very soft core.
Okay, before we go on, I want to say something.
Yes.
So this coming on your show,
yes,
totally unexpected. I won't lie. Cause so when you sort of said we must do something,
yes,
I was shocked, but pleasant shock, you know.
Yes.
And but then when I thought about it, I realized Jimmy Big Heart.
Oh,
so this is not surprising. Thank you so much
for
having me on the program.
I
appreciate you marking my birthday in this unique special way.
Since I can't buy you a car. Because I mean, if I really wanted to buy the kind of gifts, you know, I'd like to buy you some.
But you should, like based on knowing me, you know that it will not be the cars that matter.
No, it won't
right?
be the cars that matter. Exactly. The little box of chocolates.
Exactly.
The little handkerchiefs and things.
And the talking on your show and all the sort of things that money can't buy, really.
Yes.
Money can buy a car, money can't buy this.
Amongst friends, no, you can't.
Yes.
Chico, don't be jealous, son. You're way past 50, so when you're 60, I'll do the same for you. Okay, Kadari, how are you? How's life been?
Honestly, I'm in a really good place. Life is amazing. Life is good. So, I mean, for this birthday, for example, you know, I live in Lagos, and it's a party season, normally December.
Yes.
So, there was a lot of pressure to do a party.
I know, I can imagine.
And you know, I'm also a Yoruba wife, so
combination. Yeah, that's true. That's
and all that. But I kind of thought about it and I realized actually I would like to do something that's a little bit more meaningful.
Okay.
So we put together a series of training programs, which are going to become an annual thing. We're going around a couple of Nigerian universities and basically training media students.
Oh, that's
offering them training that...
Pro bono.
Yes, for free. Brought in trainers from the UK, ex-BBC colleagues who sort of volunteered their time. And so we only needed to do sort of expenses and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So we're doing Bayero, University of Uyo, and Lasu. Bayero because that's where I went to school.
Mm-hmm.
Uyo because that's where I did my NYSC.
Mm-hmm.
And Lasu because, you know, Lagos is now home. By next year...
Why not UNILAG?
Well, it's a state university. UNILAG is federal. So by next year, my hope is that we would expand this to include sort of all media schools offering sort of degree programs in media. You know, so any university that has either a journalism or a mass comm or media program will be part of this. And the idea is that we went through the curricula. And at the moment, students are still being taught things I was taught 30 years ago.
Wow.
And of course, the media business has changed.
Mm-hmm.
So we're basically saying, let's take some of the sort of industry knowledge that we have and build the next generation of journalists so that they're able to perform professionally. But we also think the money part of it is critical because ethics are only possible if you are getting paid.
Yeah.
And so part of the training we're doing is about new media models and how to set up businesses that are actually viable and make money and so allow you to pay your staff and not do what a lot of media houses do these days.
Yeah.
That sort of thing.
No, some of them actually tell you. I know there's a publisher who says, I've given you your meal tickets.
Yes, so absolutely.
We know who we're talking about. He's still licking his wounds from what happened yesterday. but... Well, since we're talking about the media, we might as well dive just straight into it. I'm sure you are not too happy with the standards that we have now.
The thing is this, what we do is really important, but like every sector, we've also fallen victim to the decay that has occurred in this country.
Mm-hmm.
And so starting from sort of the quality of education that the people who do journalism receive, down to sort of sustainability of business models and all of that. So all of that has had an impact on professionalism.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no doubt about it that there is a crisis in the Nigerian media space, particularly those who do serious journalism.
Mm.
Entertainment journalism, entertainment media is doing quite well. So the sort of soft programs...
Are you talking about the soft sell?
Yeah, I'm saying the soft sells are doing
this football, for example, is the largest
circulating... print paper in Nigeria, but the sort of serious papers, serious TV programs, serious radio programs are not doing as great, both in terms of the ability to make money and therefore sustain a quality of life for their staff, but also I think in terms of just the training and the quality of people who are going into journalism. And given how significant what we do is in society, this can't go on. So mm-hmm. there's a need, I think, for a rebirth, if you like, mm-hmm. of the Nigerian media. We need to, I think, start thinking about our standards. We need, I think, some sort of self-regulation as well, particularly because of the impact social media is having, fake news. You know, all of the things that are making our job that much more difficult actually mean that we need to differentiate ourselves because of through quality mm-hmm. and credibility. We need to sort of become trusted again so that when we do things, people believe that what we're reporting and the information we're sharing is accurate, etc., etc.
And surely we also need to change the business model.
But precisely.
You know, yeah, a absolutely. Business that can't pay its staff
yes.
you know, as and when due.
But you and I know it's not always... So that is a complex issue. It is true it's hard to make money in the media, but we do know there are those who do make the money.
I mean,
then they don't plow it back into the business. So there are ethical issues around media owners, but of course the climate as well, you're absolutely right, is... most people who do media work actually do it out of passion. Many of us don't get paid our worth. You know, in other societies, media personalities are rock stars. You know, people who sort of do journalism can sort of be comfortable and focus on just their job. Here, we are jack of all trades. To survive, we have to do all sorts of things.
Looking for something to eat.
Yes.
But you see, when it comes to the business model, and I'm sorry I have to go, a bit personal here. Punch has proved everybody wrong in the newspaper industry, for example. They're doing quite well.
Well, the people at Punch are my good friends, so I'm kind of feeling bad that I'm saying this, but what is your definition of well?
The paper, I'm talking about the business
model. The paper
model.
Sells 45,000 copies.
Well, in Nigeria, that's
a lot. In a country of 180 million people. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm saying the potential...
That is
huge, and we're not even scratching the surface. So they pay people well, they're kind of doing all right, but if you think of what the possibilities are,
then you realize
that the only reason we look at a Punch in admiration is because of that saying that in the land of the blind,
the one-eyed man is king.
So there's so much we can do. I mean, so on Saturday at the Institute of International Affairs, the sort of big birthday event that is culminating, what I'm actually doing is bringing in journalists, media owners, and business owners under one roof at the Institute of International Affairs mm-hmm. to discuss all these issues and how we sort of re-ginger the industry. We're very lucky that the Vice President, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, has been very gracious and accepted to deliver the keynote address on media renewal, which will then kickstart the conversation, mm-hmm. you know, about what is going on in the industry. So my intention, to be honest, is to force a conversation, if I can, through lobbying, through just, you know, talking to various media about us coming together as an industry and beginning to really talk about the challenges that we face, both the external ones and the sort of self-imposed ones that are based on how, you know, we do our job, etc., and see whether there are things we can begin to do to revitalize the media in this country.
Yeah, but another problem with the media is the proprietorship. A lot of the proprietors of the various media that we have really and truly are politicians. And that, again, so they are setting up these papers for influence and so on and so forth. And that again doesn't help matters, really.
It doesn't, but part of the sort of conversations I've heard, and some of them have been private conversations, I can't repeat them, but I've sort of spoken to quite a lot of people in the lead up to this thing that I'm trying to put together, and part of the conversation I've had with them is that I actually believe that you're more likely to be influential if you're credible. So it is actually in your interest to actually set up a media organization that is functional, that ticks off all the sort of indices of what is considered a proper media house. Because in the end, the amount of influence you have is directly proportionate to the amount of credibility that you have.
Unfortunately, they never say that way.
Yeah, no, they don't, because they short-termism, you know, thinking about immediate things. But, you know, there's a new generation of people coming up, and we are now, if you like, veterans.
But the
thing is, you hope that these conversations will begin to sort of also influence how they are doing things.
Well, we try to do that every day. Yes. I try to do that every day. Yeah.
Yes.
How successful I've been, I don't know. But if you want to be part of this conversation, you can tweet at us at Classic FM 973, and that at Jimmy D'Souza. I can read it on my device. And you can call 0700-1000-973. 0700-1000-973. That would be the number to call. Right. Kadaria, did you set out from the beginning to be a journalist?
Yes. So I'm one of those really lucky people who, from day one, knew what I wanted to do. Yeah,
okay.
I grew up listening to the BBC.
Right.
Up north, because, you know, the BBC House of Service is a tradition up north. So waking up to the BBC, my parents would literally put on the radio as soon as they woke up, as they were preparing, you know, to sort of start their day. I kind of remember it. I think it was about 7 that I remember vividly looking at my dad and saying, I'm going to work there one day. And I did. So, yes, I wanted to do journalism from very early on. And I think it was the influence of the BBC, just waking up and listening to both the House of Service and the English Service.
I was a bit luckier because my dad, in fact, my school, my primary school, and my dad insisted that you had to read the papers every day.
Yes.
And there was a tradition, actually, most
homes at that time, the Daily Times was sort of where you learned your English and your
English,
spelling
yes.
and your everything.
And where you read the cartoon Gap,
yes,
you remember?
Yes, yes,
That culture is gone, cartoons and things like that.
It's not such a... You know, the thing is this, I'm not one of those people who looks back with nostalgia and say,
really?
No, because, you know, life changes. The only thing constant about life is change.
It's changed.
And we've got amazing stuff now that we didn't have though. Then we've got Instagram, we've got Snapchat, we've got Twitter.
Too many.
You know, yeah, amazing stuff, you know, going on. My thing is just that the quality, whatever it is you use, whatever medium you use to communicate, if you say you're a professional journalist, then there are certain things that should be standard in the way you sort of do what you do. Verifying facts, making sure that you're not misinforming people, making sure that your news is balanced. So, you know, in the early days, people used to talk of objectivity, which is kind of difficult because everybody has an opinion. But objectivity really is balance. It's ensuring that every side is heard. Is if you're doing a story on any one thing, then you must make sure that everybody that's involved, you cover their perspective. And I think that's how you do what I consider objective journalism. And often these days we're too impatient. You know, we don't do the checks. We don't.
I think it's the speed of the news. The speed. It's no excuse. I'm just giving you the reason why that is so. Everybody wants to be the first to get it.
So my thing is this. Look, leave that to the bloggers. That's what I've always believed, that look, because the way news is consumed and the sort of new mediums of carrying information are, there's a sort of immediacy that lends itself to like you said, the breaking of news instantly. But I think what I'd like to see are media houses that are now focused on analysis, the features, the sort of things that are, well, what does it all mean? Can you help your audience make sense of it? Rushing to break, leave it to bloggers who are in the business of breaking and not checking and verifying, you know, that sort of thing. And if you
but
have
that
to
in
be,
itself is not nice.
If you've got to be in the business of breaking news, then you must accept that you are playing with your credibility. Otherwise, you won't always be the first. It's as simple as that. If you're going to verify, you won't always be the first.
Let me ask you. Because Next was a successful newspaper in terms of, you know, the production and so on and so forth. You want to talk about what went wrong there?
I've said it, I think, a few times at different places. And I think one day you and I and a few of us need to sort of sit down and write the story of next. Because I think it's a lesson on what to do right and, you know, what not to do. But I think, I think to summarize it, we basically had brilliant journalists and shitty business managers. It's really that simple. Dele was an excellent journalist, but a really bad businessman and too stubborn to listen to those who kind of knew that the business model he was pursuing was going to fail because of the nature of the journalism he was doing. So he had a model that was commercial, where he's sort of taking shareholder funds and he was supposed to sort of make money from advertising and a whole bunch of other things and then give returns to his shareholders. We were doing journalism that was shaking people in authority.
Yeah.
And unfortunately in Nigeria, government still remains the biggest enabler of business. So... If you fight government, it is very possible that they can wreck you. And did in our own case.
They did.
So the only model that would work under those sort of circumstances, I thought, and we sort of had that conversation, was some sort of foundational trust model where media is not directed towards profit and therefore you're able to attract funding from commercial sources, so donors, foundations globally that support free press, all of that, and use that sort of for 3, 4, 5 years to sort of really establish yourself and keep going. Unfortunately, by the time he sort of brought his mind round to thinking about it, I think the damage had sort of been done. Yeah,
but I also think that corporate Nigeria let us down there, because I would have thought that corporate Nigeria would have said to themselves, look, we need a Vera newspaper to get this country going. If it's going, even we businessmen are likely to make more money and so on and so forth. But they all folded their
arms. In theory, that is true. But when their primary business, you know, is threatened by government, as you know, we had a chairman who was very supportive.
Yes.
And when we started doing, and works, his primary business was in the oil and gas sector. And when we started doing the series of exposés, if you remember, on the infamous Minister of Petroleum, one of the first things she did was to threaten his primary business. And he resigned. Because at the end of the day, he's got to have he can't, because he wants to run a newspaper or be part of a newspaper, lose his primary source of income. And this is the difficulty that I alluded to earlier, because you needed a model that could not be threatened. And as long as your funding was coming from people who were vulnerable to threats from government, then you really couldn't be sustained. So you needed funding in many ways, I think, that was offshore. You know, money that was coming from... trusts and things like that. A bit like the way Sahara operates at the moment, Reporters, you know, they get big funding from Umdia, they get big funding from people like the MacArthur Foundation. Millions of dollars are sunk into Sahara. And therefore, they're not beholden to anybody. And you can't really shut them down on the basis of going to jerk up the people who either fund them or who give them advertising.
Well, unfortunately, I
see. But, you know, the thing is this, the next story I don't think is necessarily a totally negative one in the way that sometimes people put it out to be, because we influenced changes in the industry. Our coming to the market forced a lot of existing media houses to sort of wake up and rejig their model and look at the way they present information to people. And then we were responsible for, I think, some of the brightest people now in the industry. I mean, our products that actually started journalism in Next and got the Next training are now doing some of the most amazing things this country is seeing. You know, you look at someone like Chude Jidonwo with, you know, the Why Niger, the awards, the Future Awards, Red Media, all of that. You look at Tolu Ogunlesi. You know, the Cheta with SBM Intelligence. So there's a whole plethora of young people who sort of cut their teeth in Next and who've taken the skills and the ethics and all the things that they learned from Next, and they are now utilizing it across, you know, the different media space in Nigeria. And I think that's awesome.
Okay. We've got half of that, so we have to take a short break.
Okay.
And when we come back, we'll talk about that. Still have Kadaria Ahmed. Kadaria is a friend. She's a top journalist in Nigeria. I wanted to talk more sports. I'm sure she wouldn't like that. You know, so, but she's turning 50, and I'm so glad to be alive to celebrate her. And this
Thank
is
you.
The best present I think I can give to her. So we'll take a commercial break. I have to pay my dues too. And then we'll be right back.
So, what did you do when you got your first bike?
I rode it to all my friends' houses in one day.
When you got your first sunglasses?
Whoa, I was so excited. I wore it even at night.
And your first wristwatch?
Awesome. I swam with it and wore it to sleep every night for 7 good days.
And now that you're in secondary school, what will you do when you get your first smartphone?
Yay! The whole world will hear me scream.
This season, surprise your child with an MTN smartphone for as low as 13,000 Naira with a 3-month data bonus offer available at all designated MTN stores nationwide.
Appeared. Then it finally came, and he never stopped smiling the whole day. When he took his first step, he went straight to the kitchen. And on his first day in school, I couldn't hold back the tears of joy. Now that he has come of age, I can't wait to see what his reaction will be when I give him his first MTN smartphone tomorrow.
This season, surprise your child with an MTN smartphone for as low as 13,000 Naira with a 3-month data bonus offer available at all designated MTN stores nationwide.
Ladies and gentlemen, live from the Classic FM studios in Lagos, it's The Discourse with Jimmy Disu, brought to you by MTN.
Welcome back to The Discourse with Jimmy Disu, brought to you by MTN. And I still have with me Kadaria Ahmed, a topmost journalist who's turning 50 next week. Wednesday, it's on Wednesday,
13th,
right?
December, yes.
On Wednesday, it's
Wednesday. Oh, I was actually also, it's amazing that the 50th has fallen on a Wednesday, because I was actually born on a Wednesday. Yes.
Uh-huh. So. What was growing up like for you, before I forget? Especially in the north, where... I believe that female kids were more restricted than they'd have been down south.
Yeah, okay, so the North in many ways has actually regressed. I know it's difficult for people to believe, but when we were growing up, this militant Islam that you now see didn't exist. I remember a few months ago, we had a fire at home, so we lost a lot of pictures. So when my sisters stumble across old pictures, we share them. And my sister sent me pictures of me as a baby with my parents, and I was so excited, I put them on Facebook. And the reaction was, oh my God, your parents look so cosmopolitan. Mm. Oh my God, your mom is not, you know, her hair is not tied. Oh my God. And so this whole notion of the way the North is now is totally different from when I was growing up, although it was a middle class thing as well, obviously.
Okay.
But even among people that are considered working class, for example, there was nothing like hijab, for example. Life growing up was good. I had a dad who was a big advocate of female education.
Mm-hmm.
And sort of made sure that we all went to school. Not everybody around us went to school, but we did. And it's why part of what I'm doing on Saturday is also launching scholarships in his name for female journalists in those three Nigerian universities. So Bayero, University of Uyo, again Lasu, and we're going to offer full scholarships to three girls studying journalism in those three universities, and every year we'll do another three, because the degrees are four-year programs. So by the time the scholarship program fully matures, there'll be 12 people. And then I've kind of persuaded my sister, who's a lawyer, that when she turns 50 in 2 years' time, she should institute, you know, a law scholarship for female students in his name as well. Mm-hmm. And then so 12 will become 24, and then my sister, who's a PR guy, woman, and then the sociologist and the filmmaker, and then that way.
How many sisters do you have?
So we're five girls and two
boys.
Wow. Yes.
I imagine, I mean, you're a very pretty woman, even if I say so myself.
Oh,
so I can imagine what your house would have looked like when you were a teenager.
Yeah. My dad
I would have jumped the wall to see
my dad was very stern and very careful and very protective. But
really?
Yes. I mean,
Nobody could jump the wall or anything. Or whistle past.
Well, they did try. And the way they sort of tried to get to us was through our male cousins. So, you know, we had a lot of boy. And so they would become friends with them.
and then come to the house.
Yes,
come visit them.
Yes.
Same old trick, you know.
Yes.
Okay, I have some tweets here. Onimisi Robert says that, he says you're a super fantastic guest. And he says that, he says, one, should a newspaper or journalist take sides with a political party and openly express it? And then two, to the two questions, what has happened to, if in doubt, drop it, in modern day journalism?
Okay, so with the first question, actually the answer surprisingly is yes.
Yeah.
You are allowed to have political opinions. You are allowed to come out and endorse. And in fact, traditionally, in places where ideology plays a big part in politics, mm-hmm. what you tend to have are media houses that are aligned, you know, to ideology. So they're either to the left or to the right or to the middle. And that sort of tends to influence their thinking about sort of who to support in terms of elections. The difference is that preference is known.
And
so there's no attempt to deceive people into believing that you are neutral, and therefore what you are reporting is neutral. I don't know if you understand what that means.
So it's perfectly.
It's all about you know how it is presented, and so it is perfectly acceptable for someone to say I'm going to endorse Buhari and do an editorial around it and put up the reasons why they think that President Buhari should run in 2019. What is not acceptable is for you to be endorsing Buhari and pretending you're not, and then therefore demarcating other candidates under the guise that you are an independent and objective journalist, right? On principle, I try not to take sides, because I think it becomes a little bit more difficult and people question your credibility. But in places, like I said, where ideology plays a big part in politics, it is perfectly normal and perfectly acceptable. Mm. It just shouldn't affect the way you do your work. If you give your candidate 5 minutes, you must give the other candidate as well five minutes. Yeah.
Well, I generally take it, like the last election that we had, I had to take a stand that Jonathan had to go.
Yeah.
I didn't market Buhari, but I just said that I believed it was time for Jonathan to let.
But you were open about it.
I was open about it.
Exactly.
Yes,
and that's it. Yeah. So yes. That's the difference. But when people are not, and they sort of try to sell a viewpoint that is supposedly neutral, when really it isn't, and I think that's where the sort of ethical issues come in. But so there's a bit of deception involved.
What position will you be taking in 2019? How do you assess Buhari so far?
Okay, so you see, I've got the VP coming to launch my scholarship.
So you, have to,
you, you are not going to put me in trouble. I'm very excited by the fact that Professor Oshibajo is coming to deliver keynote and also hand over scholarships to this female journalist student.
I've known him.
And Jimmy, you are not going to ruin that for me, okay?
No, but I tell you, I've known JB all my life. I was in primary school with him, in uni with him.
Yeah.
And he doesn't like me. He don't want to listen. He thinks I'm a rascal.
No, but, I mean, the truth is that, look, I would like to see, what I'd hate is for Nigeria to have to choose between Buhari and Atiku alone.
Oh, that's all I would say.
That's all I'm going to say.
Well, it says it all, really, because it means you want a third choice.
I am just saying,
but I'm telling you what it means.
A country of 180 million, where sort of 70% of them are sort of under the age of 30, deserve to have choices that allow them to see on ballot papers people who are closer to them in age, in experience, in everything that you can think of.
I give a round of applause.
And if the VP doesn't show up, yeah, I'm going to haul you on stage to deliver the keynote instead. Okay. So,
but what was your reaction? No, it's not the VP I'm talking about. What was your reaction when you saw or got to hear that Atiku was going to put in another bid to run for president?
I feel sorry for him.
If I'm being honest.
And yes. This is, I know him. So he might get to hear this and I might get a call and I don't know. I feel sorry for him because I think he's surrounded by people who are incapable of telling him the truth.
Mm.
I think he's surrounded by people who see the way he spends money to drive his political ambition and just see it as an opportunity to sort of just enrich themselves within the next 1 year. Could Atiku have been president? Yes. But I think that time has passed, in my view. I think there was an opportunity and a window.
When was that?
I think his fight with Obasanjo, he could have impeached Obasanjo at one time if he'd wanted to. And basically become the president because he had the total control of the two houses. They were willing to do what he wanted them to do. But, you know, people sued for peace and he made peace with his boss. And I guess he didn't read Machiavelli, you know, who said when you start a fight, you have to finish it. Because you can see that President Obasanjo has not forgotten that fight and is determined to finish that fight. But, you know, I think when you talk to people who are close to the Waziri of Adamawa, and I know quite a few, they talk to you of a man who understands business, who is good with people, who understands structure, who understands alliances and all of the things that they believe would be make him a great president. The problem is that in life, not just when it comes to politics, but in most even relationships, sometimes everything is about timing.
And perception.
Timing.
Perception, very important.
Timing. But timing tends to influence perception.
You think so? I mean, there's this perception hanging around him. Perception of corruption.
Of corruption, yeah. Yes. And I'm saying 10 years, was it 10 years? No, so, sort of. When he was VP, that might not have mattered. But over the time has passed and this has now become embedded in people's psyche. And his people, he will keep telling you, well, prove it. You know, he's never been convicted. He's never. It doesn't really matter because people believe it.
Yeah.
This is what I'm saying. It's become entrenched in people's minds over the last sort of however many years it is. And so when I say I feel sorry for him, I think part of my prayer for myself and I think for anybody that we love is that you never reach a stage where you never have anyone who can look you in the face and tell you the truth.
Hmm.
And unfortunately, I think with Waziri of Adamawa, he's reached that stage where, because he's surrounded by people for whom the financial benefits of him running is huge, they're not capable of telling him, we think it is time to just be a statesman and maybe a kingmaker.
If you had that opportunity, if after this program he called you and asked you, what did you mean by that? Do you think I can make it? Why do you think I can make it?
I would tell him that Nigeria is at a serious crossroad, actually. And right now, we need some hard reset. And my view is that that hard reset cannot be by 70-something-year-old men, both of whom have held office and haven't really done much for Nigeria, if we're being honest. So why should anybody trust that when they get a second chance is going to be any better? I think we are in need of healing in this country. We're in need of unity. And you need someone who can think outside the box and who is capable of being a bit mad.
But some people will tell you that there are no other people in the horizon.
That's not true. It's because we've refused to reform our political parties. So the process through which politicians who sort of run for public office emerges is still fundamentally flawed.
Mm-hmm.
And if we don't democratize the political parties or create new political parties, then this is the problem we get. But look, Nigeria is unraveling, Jimmy. People don't like to talk about it, but that's the truth. Look around you. There is low-level conflict around every nook and corner of this country. We sit in our comfortable places in Lagos, in Abuja, and we think everything is going well. It isn't. In Taraba, in Benue State, you know, there are killings taking place. Banditry in Zamfara is leading to sort of whole villages being wiped out. I'm from Zamfara. So I kind of hear the news. It's not mainstream because it's not sexy. Because it's not Fulani versus, a tribe that are Christian, because it's, Fulani versus other northern Muslims. You know, you understand what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Niger Delta, there's a lot of tension. There's really no part of this country that now is without some sort of low-level conflict. And it points to one thing, which is that the state is failing, right? And my biggest fear for Nigeria is that we're going to reach a stage where it's going to be just a gradual unraveling, a bit like, you end up like a Congo, where you've got a government in the center, but really, once you leave the center, the influence is not felt.
It's
and
offense.
Then, little pockets of, militias control this area, and another set of militia control that area. I mean, I was reading an article that Jim Uwodo wrote, that I thought was really good, where he sort of looked at these issues that I have, I'm raising, and which I actually have raised before with a few friends. And he did a great job of explaining this thing that I'm talking about. And that's the big danger that is facing us. It's not going to be a big conflict that everybody thinks, or a civil war breaking out. It's little pockets of Nigeria becoming ungovernable. And then, it's spreading, it's spreading. Because the state can't cope anymore.
Right, let me quickly read out the numbers. Our lines are open, and the number to call would be 0700-1000-973. Let me go through it again. 0700-1000-973. The picture you just painted now is frightening. I tell you this, I was frightened. And I don't think the situation is even helped by our politicians.
No, we've not been very lucky with our political class. They're not even intelligent enough to understand that if they are to keep the gravy train going, this country needs to be functional.
I got a caller for you now.
Right.
Hello, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Yes, you are.
Hi, Jimmy. My name is Namdi.
Yes, Namdi, how are you?
Fine, thank you. Just calling to say that I'm really enjoying the program today.
Thank you.
I think this is about the best guest that you've ever had.
Okay.
Today, I'm just so excited listening to her.
Okay.
And really, really so excited from all the things that she's been telling us of our Nigeria of today and mm-hmm. what it used to be before now.
Yes.
And I'm just trying to find out if books that she's reading or something. And it would really, really be nice to really get more, to know more about her thoughts for this country.
All right, thank you. Okay, thank you very much.
thank you. That's a very gracious and nice comment.
You get a lot of that, and I was going to ask your comment on that, what you just did. You see somebody who is quite intelligent, good at what they do, next thing you tell them to run. I have another caller. Okay. Good afternoon. Hello?
Hello?
Good afternoon.
Hello?
Afternoon. Yes, I can hear you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Mr. Jimmy.
Good afternoon, sir.
My name is Mr. Richard, calling from VIAC.
Yes, Mr. Richard, how are you?
I'm fine.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Happy Sunday.
Yeah, go on, just go on.
Okay, please, I want to make comment on what she has said concerning Atiku.
Yes, okay, that would be nice to hear.
Okay, I want to say, what about if God has chosen Atiku?
What was the question?
He said he wants to know if what if God has chosen him.
Okay, so
no.
Yeah, we're good.
I'm sorry. If people will say I'm committing blasphemy, but I think God is one of the biggest problems in Nigeria. We're very religious people, but we have very little faith and very little spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you think about the sort of number of churches and the mosques that we have dotting this country,
mm-hmm.
this country should be heaven on earth.
Yeah.
All right? But it's not like that. And why? Is because religion has now been used to sort of replace responsibility. You know, we do something wrong. You know, people don't study and then they want to pass exams by praying. How does that work? My kind of faith is the sort of faith that says God has also said you need to do for yourself. He's not passive. You know, you're not a passive person. God is giving you qualities that mean that you can change your life. I mean, I'll tell you a really short story quickly.
Mm-hmm.
A spiritual teacher, very famous, people come from all over the world to see him. And then this merchant decided to visit him. And then sort of when he got there, he ran in very excited. Oh, you know, I came to see you because I hear about all the wonderful things about you. But, you know, I have such belief in God. I'm a great believer. I'm such a great believer in God that, you know, my camel that I came with, I didn't tie him. You know, I just, you know, left him there because I know God will look after him myself for me. And the spiritual teacher looked at him and said, "You fool, go and tie that camel. God will not do for you what you can do for yourself."
Mm.
And that is the truth. You know, why is it that the least spiritual countries or the least, not let me say not spiritual, the least religious countries in the world today are perhaps the most advanced?
Yeah, organized.
Yeah, go to the Nordic countries. And all the qualities that they have that are preached, so we religion preaches tolerance, peace, loving your neighbor, looking after those who are less fortunate that are vulnerable. This country, Sweden, Denmark, all these countries that are not very religious, these are qualities that are enshrined in their laws and their, you know, constitution. Yeah. They look after the most vulnerable in society. Everybody is respected. People obey rules. People, you know, they build societies that are functional where people can live decent lives. And yet, we are in church and in mosque every day. And all we are talking about is our enemies. We don't see the role we play in having the kind of life that we have. We don't take any responsibility at all. So that's not to say that I'm not saying that that if God, whatever. But, you know, why won't God want to give Nigeria a ruler, for goodness sake, that for once will do what is right by Nigeria? It would be nice if God actually thought, you know what, I'd like a 45-year-old radical who's going to come and turn this country around. That would be nice. And I think so that our responsibility and my answer to my caller is if he loves Nigeria, he should pray that God's mind is tilted towards.
But God doesn't, God never does wrong.
Nigeria, let's pray that God chooses the man that will work for Nigeria. So he sounds like a prayerful man.
Okay, we'll take our last call for the day. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Hello, yes, go on. Yes, this is that.
Okay. Yeah, I want to agree with you, madam. Instead of a school, we have done something with the seniors, I agree with the time. Yes, I agree with you, sir. At the same time, we should give him a time because he's more than told the proper agenda. Keep the seniors. If not, Baba could have been the first time to work. And mind you, he's not doing the same thing with the seniors right now. He has the percentage of the seniors. He not agree with me. He has the percentage here. That is that. And now, it's now someone that's very fan. So, now, I'll ask a question for you. Nigerian journalists, do you think that they are practicing, they are doing it right the way they are doing this now? Because, mind you, most of the media is owned by politicians. What can they do to just get independent? And about the bill, the bill that they are prepared with money, how about that? It's like, for me, it's like they're dead completely. What do you think? Thank you.
Yeah.
I mean, the line wasn't too great, so I didn't understand and everything he said, but I heard him, I think, talk about what you sort of said earlier about politicians owning
media houses
and how this can change. And I'm saying, look, there's a decay in Nigeria that has basically dragged in virtually every institution that we have. I don't know why people think the media is going to be exempt. Nigerian journalists are not, you know, dropping down from heaven and from the moon. They are Nigerians. And so the decay that is in the society is bound to have an impact on them. Am I saying we fold our arms up? Of course not, which is why I'm sort of doing all the things I'm doing. But I'm saying that there is a direct correlation between financial independence and media independence, editorial independence. It is not possible for you to do ethical journalism that is independent, that is fair, if you do not have money. Because you then rely on the people you're covering, the people you're supposed to be holding to account, to look after you. I've been lucky, and people say to me, oh God, your program, Straight Talk, where were you so, you know, you could be brutal, you could be this, you could be that. Because I'd had a career in the BBC before coming here, by the time I came and started doing journalism here, I could create independent sources of income. Which meant that if I interview you, you cannot hand me an envelope and I take it because I don't need your money. I don't know if you understand what I mean.
Of course,
it's a very significant difference between that and the people who don't get paid salaries and therefore, to pay their bills, they actually rely on the patronage of the people that they talk to. So the whole modeling has to change. But like I said, look, we in the same way that we're hoping we will do things that will sort of shift out of the way the traditional politicians we have in this country, is the same thing we have to think for all our sectors, whether it's the judiciary, whether it's the police, whether it's the media. We have to start doing the things that allow us, whether it's policy, whether it is setting up independent businesses that are viable, doing the things that allow us to begin to change standards and enshrine professionalism in everything that we do. I don't think it's going to be easy, but it's doable.
I hope so too. So, Kadaria, yes, happy birthday. Okay.
Thank you, Jimmy.
I still call you on Wednesday morning. I'll be your first caller. Happy birthday. I wish you all the best.
Thank you so much for having me.
I think the journalism profession has a lot to thank you for, especially in editing Next.
Thank you.
I feel so proud, thank you to have been a part of that.
Thank you so much.
Yes,
Jimmy.
I feel so proud.
Thank you.
And, you know, in there are not too many women that have edited national dailies.
Absolutely.
I don't know if you know that.
Fewer northern women.
In fact, I'm trying to think in my career if I've ever come across a woman who has edited a daily.
Wasn't Amma an editor at The Guardian? Amma Ogan.
Was she an editor or a writer?
No, I think she was.
I think she was an editor.
I think she was probably the first.
Editor of The Sunday.
Yes, I think she edited The Sunday. And then, you know, now we have Ijoma doing This Day.
Yes, Ijoma Wagogo.
So she's this day. But it's still.
But we're almost a dying breed, honestly.
Yes.
Well, thank you very, very much for coming.
Thank you, Jimmy. Thank you so much.
This is my best birthday present to you.
Oh, it's really appreciated. Yes, I'm grateful. Thank you so much. And thank you to the Classic team. And